there's no question, of course, that our sexuality is a very important part of our lives, and God created it so. He made the male and female at the beginning, and He designed the mechanism, He designed the means, He designed the meaning of sexual activity.
Every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. The streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. And teach me some melodious song, sung by flaming tongues above. And praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. And here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. And Jesus sent me when a stranger, wandering far from the fold, and He to rescue me from danger interposed His precious blood.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a trip of a lifetime that celebrates all things Israel. From November 17th through to the 27th, 2016, join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we explore Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, you'll visit Via Dolorosa, the Mount of Olives, Beit She'an, Caesarea, Mount Carmel, and many more amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hillary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
I'd like to personally invite you to join Hillary and myself for a wonderful and rich experience in the land of Israel in November 2016. We're calling this trip Awaken 2016 Israel. Whether this is your first trip to Israel or you're returning with us to this beautiful, significant country, imagine a journey where you'll immerse your senses, and deepen your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Most of the key events in Scripture took place in the land of Israel. And we'll visit places whose names have probably been familiar to you for many years. We'll be fascinated by the historical sites and events and be able to soak up spiritual significance that is associated with them. This is a vacation like no other. You'll enjoy the sights, sounds, and great food of the Holy Land, as well as wonderful warm fellowship with like-minded travelers. And we've set aside ample quality time to refresh and rejuvenate the spirit. Towards the end of our journey, we'll stop and take time in the Word of God together. Hilary and I will teach at a two-day haven of reflection in a private venue right on the shore of Lake Galilee. Our hope is that we may encounter the living Christ and come away in a deeper relationship with Him. Awaken 2016 Israel holds the potential to invigorate us physically, to enrich us socially, and to refresh us spiritually. Like many who have journeyed with us before, you may come home knowing you'll never be quite the same again. Don't miss this opportunity. Please join Hilary, me, and the Living Truth family on this exciting journey. We hope to see you in Israel in November 2016.
Save these dates, November 17th to the 27th, 2016. To reserve your spot now, visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Israel, Awaken 2016. It's your time.
This is a repeat program from Charles Price. We are all soulful, spiritual, and sexual beings. There is a manual for gender and sexuality. It's called the Bible. Today's message is called The Purpose and Pitfalls of Sex.
If you have your Bible with you, I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and chapter 7. Let me remind you, for those who have been here in recent weeks, and inform you if you are here for the first time, that we are looking at the moment at a series, seeing what the Bible has to say about gender and sexuality. This, of course, is a huge issue in any day, in any generation, at any time, in any part of the world. But in the Western world, of which we're a part, this has been through such change in the last few decades that it is important that we ask, what does the Scripture have to say about this issue? And we are looking each week at some different aspect of that. And I want to talk today about the purpose and the pitfalls of sex. And I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 18 down to chapter 7 and verse 7. Paul writes there, "Flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits are committed outside his body. But he who sins sexually sins against his own body. And do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. Now, for the matters you wrote about, it is good for a man not to marry. But since there is so much immorality, each man should have his own wife, and each woman her own husband. The husband should fulfill his marital duty to his wife, and likewise the wife to her husband. The wife's body does not belong to her alone, but also to her husband. In the same way, the husband's body does not belong to him alone, but also to his wife. Do not deprive each other, except by mutual consent and for a time, so that you may devote yourselves to prayer. Then come together again so that Satan will not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. I say this as a concession, not as a command. I wish that all men were as I am, but each man has his own gift from God. One has this gift, another has that. That's as far as I'm going to read. Around 50 years ago, the so-called sexual revolution began to gain a momentum. The seeds for this had been sown probably 100 years ago. There are a number of streams that run into this river of the sexual revolution that we have seen in the Western world. Earlier in this century and at the end of the last century, Sigmund Freud, who is the father of psychoanalysis, developed his theory of personality that has had a great impact in this area, though his theories have been challenged. Basically, he stated that our behavior is governed by a tension between two things. On the one hand, there is the pleasure principle. This is the driving force of the ego, said Freud, that seeks gratification of its needs, its wants, and its urges. And this includes hunger, thirst, anger, and sex. We naturally pursue these desires because they are desires that are within us. And when these needs are not met, the result, said Freud, is anxiety and tension. But this pleasure principle is offset by what Freud called the reality principle. That is, in the realities of life, we can't always get what we want. And we often have to defer pleasure or deny ourselves pleasure because if we pursue it, the consequences are negative and greater than the pleasures. So, for instance, you might want to eat a cream bun or you might want to eat a gallon of ice cream. But the reality principle says that if I do that, I'm going to put on pounds, and I don't want to put on pounds, so I deny myself the desirable food, or I defer it to more appropriate context as part of a meal or something, in order to not have to endure the reality principle, which Freud said is usually associated with pain, with something undesirable. And so we educate ourselves to become responsible by weighing up the benefits of the pleasure principle with the pains of the reality principle. When it comes to sex and sexual relationships, whether with a particular person or randomly, the pleasure principle that appeals to us and gives us that desire is offset by the reality principle, which gives us the consequences of that. So things like unwanted pregnancies, things like sexually transmitted diseases, in Freud's assessment, prevent us pursuing that pleasure principle if these are possible outcomes and we don't want them. But if we can eliminate the risks, then the pleasure principle can operate with limited negative consequences. In 1959, the availability of the contraceptive pill reduced unwanted pregnancies as an option in sexual relationships. In 1969 in Canada, the legalizing of abortion meant that if you did conceive, you could reject the fetus and get away scot-free. Although in actual fact, it rarely is getting away scot-free. If we can make condoms available to high school students, we can reduce the risks involved, and therefore we raise the pleasure principle and the possibilities. Now, this has become a basis of modern ethics. Go for pleasure, follow the desires and urges as long as you can avoid negative consequences and avoid the pain they might bring. And if you can avoid the painful realities, the reality principle, then the sky's the limit. Hence, in popular ethics, there is rarely an objective criteria for what is right and wrong. There is only the balancing of the pleasure principle with the reality principle, the pleasures over against the pains, and if the pleasures win, you can endure the limited amount of pains that may be associated with it. And therefore, in modern values, for an example, sexual abstinence outside of marriage has become a limited pain, because we've made it so, that we are willing to endure if you recognize it's there at all in order to enjoy the pleasure of it. So rather than a disciplined sexuality, we have an ill-disciplined pleasure-seeking as the prize. And this, in the latter part of the 19th century, early part of the 20th century, laid the ground for the sexual revolution that came in later decades. Then in the 1960s, a book was published by Michael Joseph Fletcher, who was a university professor. His book was entitled Situation Ethics, and it's been regarded as one of the most influential books of the 20th century, though it may not be the best known book of the 20th century, but its influence has been immense. Fletcher's basic principle is that nothing is universally right or universally wrong. Nothing is intrinsically good or intrinsically bad. Good and bad are things which happen to actions in different situations. So the same thing in one situation might be good, in another situation might be bad. The only thing that's intrinsically good, says Fletcher, is love. Anything done in love is good. This gave a rationale for separating our behavior from many objective criteria and measuring it only by the subjective criteria. If I'm doing this as an expression of love, then it is intrinsically good. And so sexual behavior became divorced from any objective morality. It became attached to a subjective ethic, and sexual permissivism is the logical result. Now, the starting point for a Christian who has brought their lives under the Lordship of Jesus Christ is the authority of His Word. And there is in Scripture an objective morality that is based on the character of God, essentially, and its outworking is revealed to us in different ways through the Scriptures. Fletcher was right when he said it begins with love. Jesus said the whole of the law can be summed up in love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. And the second command is like unto it, love your neighbor as yourself. But there is also a moral structure to all behavior given to us in Scripture, which says what and why certain things are an expression of love and why certain things that may otherwise seem valid are not an expression of love. Now, there's no question, of course, that our sexuality is a very important part of our lives, and God created it so. He made the male and female at the beginning, and He designed the mechanism, He designed the means, He designed the meaning of sexual activity. But sexuality, like most other things, has fallen into trouble. What holds the potential for the highest good and the greatest joys can sometimes bring the deepest hurts and the most painful sadnesses. And I have no doubt that here this morning there are many of us who have been damaged either by our own sexual activity or by sexual activity where we have been on the receiving end of abuse and use. So I want to try and look at this clearly and compassionately. And I want to talk this morning about the purpose and the pitfalls of sex. And I want to talk first about the purpose of sex. And I want to base it on what Paul writes in these verses we read in 1 Corinthians. He is actually in this verses saying why marriage is good. And he says, if you marry, that's good. If you stay single, that's good. Personally, he said, I prefer you were like me. He was a single man. And he tells us why. But if you marry, that's good too. And here in verse 3 of 1 Corinthians chapter 7, he makes this statement, the husband should fulfill his marital duty to his wife and likewise the wife to her husband. Now, what does he mean by this phrase, should fulfill his marital duty? I mean, marital duty sounds pretty cold, doesn't it? You know, this is my marital duty. Well, there are two phrases in Genesis that are used to describe the sexual relationship. One I referred to last week in Genesis 4 and verse 1, where the King James correctly translates it, Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain. Now, the NIV and some other translations change this to explain what is meant by it. The NIV says Adam lay with his wife and she conceived and gave birth to Cain, which is fine. That is descriptive of what actually happened. But this word knew is a very important word. It's the Hebrew word yada. And I mentioned this last week. According to Strong's Hebrew definitions, which I consulted, he says to know in this setting means to know properly another person, to experience, to discover, to give to have, to take from, to be privy to be sure of. All of these, he says, describe the meaning of this word yada, to know. It is a knowledge which gives the deepest kind of intimacy between two people that involves the whole person, spirit, soul, heart, and body, and is expressed in that physical sexual act. But there's an awful lot more about Adam knowing Eve than simply the sexual act and producing a baby. Someone sent me this quotation from Tim Keller this week. To be loved but not known is comforting but superficial. To be known but not loved is our greatest fear. But to be fully known and truly loved is a lot like being loved by God. It is what we need more than anything. It liberates us from pretense. You don't have to pretend anything to anybody. It humbles us out of our self-righteousness and fortifies us for any difficulty life can throw at us. That's the intensity of being known. And that is the word that is used here. Adam knew his wife Eve. And that was the context for the sexual relationship. The other phrase used is well known. Genesis 2 verse 24, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife and they'll become one flesh. Now this one flesh, of course, includes the physical, but it is more than the physical. It is the spiritual oneness, a vital communion of heart, of which the physical union is its consummation and its expression. But the physical union without that spiritual and heartfelt union is left empty. And so this one flesh description is not about two people coming together sexually, though that is an expression of it, but it's about being known, being loved, belonging, and made one. There are two primary purposes for the sexual relationship, therefore. One is relationship. It's building a depth of union between two people that expresses the spiritual and heartfelt union, expressing it in a sexual way. The other primary purpose is reproduction. Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain. There's a third R, which is the most popular one today in all likelihood, which is not part of the intention. That is that sex is recreation. It is purely for self-indulgence. And any kind of sexuality which is purely self-indulgent is completely detached from the purpose which God created it. Now, every society sets boundaries around sexuality. Every society does. And in the development of Western civilization over a number of centuries, Christianity has been the main force in setting those boundaries. And what the scripture says about sex. Now, historically, the church has not always portrayed a positive view of sexuality, as scripture in fact does, and probably with a proper concern to avoid sexual sin and avoid lustful situations. It's majored on avoiding the dangers and probably left a guilt complex about the joys of sexuality. And some of those boundaries were unnecessarily repressive. So they developed a rather distorted view of sex. According to Philip Yancey, during the Middle Ages and up until the Reformation, and even after the Reformation for a short while, the church authorities had issued edicts forbidding sex on certain days. It was forbidden on Thursdays because that was the day of Christ's arrest. Forbidden on Fridays, because that was the day of his death. Forbidden on Saturdays in honor of the Virgin Mary. Forbidden on Sundays in honor of departed saints. Monday was a good day. So was Tuesday. Wednesdays occasionally, but it was prohibited on most Wednesdays for a series of different reasons, having to do with feasts and departed saints and other things. But in addition to that, they had to abstain for the 40-day fast period before Christmas, the 40-day fast period before Easter, and the 40-day fast period before Pentecost. Now, Pentecost was 50 days after Easter. So in a 90-day period, there was a 10-day gap in the middle, which fortunately contained two Mondays and two Tuesdays. And you probably took your vacation during that week. It was also banned on feast days and days of the apostles, and it was estimated there were 44 days a year that remained available for marital sex. I'm not kidding. This is historically the case. Although one historian I read says there is no evidence that many Christians took this seriously. Well, it was probably a useful form of contraception as well. Reduce it to 44 days a year, and you probably reduce the size of the family. But it's no wonder the Christians developed a paranoid fear of sex with this kind of restriction. Now, the scripture not only affirms its importance and its place, but Paul writes here in 1 Corinthians 7 in verse 3, I just read this verse, the husband shall fulfill his marital duty to his wife and likewise the wife to her husband. And then he gives an interesting reason in verse 4. The wife's body does not belong to her alone, but also to her husband. In the same way, the wife's body does not belong to him alone, but also to his wife. By the way, outside of marriage, you do not belong to each other. Marriage, beginning with a wedding day, all cultures have a wedding celebration of some kind, whether it's a one-day event, whether it's a three-day or a week-long event, they all have some celebration of the beginning of this relationship, because a wedding is a surrender publicly, that is affirmed publicly, that I no longer belong to myself, I belong to my wife, or I belong to my husband. And Paul affirms that. However, this verse could be used, and sadly has been used, as a means of abuse, where one says to the other, you belong to me, therefore I demand of you sex. What does it mean for a wife's body to belong to a husband and a husband's body to belong to his wife? Well, in Ephesians 5, verse 28, Paul says there, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies, because you belong to each other. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one hated his own body. He feeds it and cares for it, just as Christ does the church, for we are members of his body. Paul, by the way, always brings these things back to Christ as the source of our understanding of some of these things. And he is saying there that a man loves his wife as his own body because she belongs there and now one, and he is to treat her the way he would treat his own body in independence of her. He cares, he looks after, he says he feeds, he nourishes. The context in which a wife's body belongs to her husband is that he cherishes her and loves her and cares for her and looks after her, and she is safe with him and she is protected with him. And then he says in verse 5, do not deprive each other except by mutual consent and for a time, so you may devote yourselves to prayer, then come together again so that Satan will not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. What he's saying there is keep the sexual relationship in repair. Don't deprive each other. This is by mutual consent for some better purpose, like devoting yourself to prayer. But then he says, be understanding too, that if you don't come back together, Satan may tempt. And so the relationship should be kept wholesome and healthy. Now, this has been a significantly difficult area to manage, and it has to be worked on in marriage. The sexual instinct is a powerful force, and it must come under discipline. If it's the glue in a marriage, you cannot build anything just with glue. You are gluing together two things of substance. That's what glue is for. If there is no substance, the glue tears and destroys. And so the focus in a marriage, in how Paul teaches about it, is that we love our wives as we love our own bodies. We care, we nurture, we look after, we protect. And in that context, we're able to give ourselves to each other. But let me talk, secondly, just for a few minutes, about the pitfalls of sex. There's an awful lot we can say here, and I don't have time to say an awful lot, but let me keep it to these verses that I read to you. I didn't read verse 13 of chapter 6, but in the second part of that verse, he says, the body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And then in verse 18, he says, flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits are outside his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body, which means himself, but also means his wife. They've been made one, you see. He's explained that. That is why, by the way, sexual sin is different to other sin in its consequences. Because this is a sin that is against your own body. Now, what does Paul mean by sexual immorality when he uses that phrase here? There are two main definitions in the New Testament of sexual immorality in heterosexual relationships. I'm going to talk on another Sunday about homosexuality, but the two main definitions are adultery, which is extramarital sex, that is sex outside of the marriage relationship, and the other is the word fornication, which is premarital sexual relationships, that is prior to a marriage. Adultery, of course, breaks the oneness, the bond, the commitment. This word fornication, which actually is translated by the NIV as sexual immorality, which sounds much more general, but it is a translation of the word that is translated in many other translations as fornication, has been much discussed and debated as to what it really means. Some argue the word refers only to promiscuity, but not to sex in a loving, though unmarried, relationship. But it's very hard to substantiate that argument in the light of this passage. Let me just show you Paul's argument. In chapter 7, and the second part of verse 1, he says, it is good for a man not to marry. But since there is so much immorality, each man should have his own wife and each woman her own husband. Now, it may seem a very low-level argument to say the way to avoid sexual immorality is to marry. Sex is not the only reason for marriage, and if it is the primary reason, statistics tell us it doesn't last very long. But it is part of the equation, of course. It's part of the reason why we want to marry. And he says that if you marry, you avoid sexual immorality. That is to say that when you marry, you avoid sexual activity outside of the marriage by the fact that you have got married. So he is arguing there about a couple in a loving relationship, but he says, if you need to marry, do, because of the option, which he calls immorality. Later in the chapter, chapter 7, verse 36, he argues this way, if anyone thinks he is acting improperly towards the virgin he is engaged to, And if she is getting along in years and he feels he ought to marry, he should do as he wants. He is not sinning. They should get married. But the man who has settled the matter in his own mind and who is under no compulsion but has control over his own will and who has made up his mind not to marry the virgin, this man also does the right thing. So then he who marries the virgin does right, but he who does not marry her does even better. Now here's his argument. If they are engaged, a man engaged to a virgin woman, and he uses the phrase, he's engaged to her, the virgin he is engaged to, and they want a sexual relationship, he says they should get married. Now, he doesn't say, if you are engaged and the sexual desires are strong, then go ahead and sleep together since you are committed to each other, so it's okay. He doesn't say that. He says, if the desire is that strong, get married. In other words, premarital sexual intercourse is not the option. Same thing is clear from verse 2. Because of the temptation to immorality, each man should have his own wife and each woman her own husband. He doesn't say, because of the temptation to immorality, get a girlfriend and stick with her. Nor that a commitment to marriage, as in the case of the man who's engaged to a virgin, justifies the act of sexual intercourse before marriage. Now he says, if your desire for sexual relations with your fiancé is that strong, go ahead and get married. Because marriage is the context that God designed for the sexual relationship. Because it is a context where you do not belong to yourselves anymore. You belong to each other. You are in that oneness that is recognized by society as well. But it is a oneness that brings you into that knowledge of one another and experience of one another where the sexual relationship is not only necessary but important. This highlights the value of sex in marriage and prohibits sexual relationships outside of marriage. Now, there seems to be currently an assumption among many Christians that premarital sex is permitted. It's okay, especially if you're going to be married and you're planning to be. Or at least it's not as sinful as it used to be. But we cannot conclude this from reading the writings of Paul. My daughter and son-in-law would normally be here. They're not here this morning because they are awaiting the birth of their first baby, who is 2 days overdue. And they are about to make a huge discovery. That the beautiful attraction of the magnetic power of love and sexual desire that brings people together in marriage. After the next day or two, when this beautiful little baby girl is born, I know she'll be beautiful because she has her grandmother's genes in her. The worst thing about this, by the way, is I'm going to be married to a grandmother in a few days' time. And this beautiful little baby is going to need their unrelenting love and patience and money and time and energy and discipline. We can't go there because we got a baby at home. And it's going to last for at least 20 years. And you know something? That is what it's all about. The power of love and sex is to bring us to the place where it brings out of us the best thing it possibly could, selflessness and unconditional love. Where you live your lives in the interest of somebody else. But it's not God's trick. It's actually what it's about. And if we don't know that, sex will become a broken plaything. And not only will the sex itself be broken, but it will break us in the process. And God would save us from that by saying, I've given you the mechanism, I've given you the means, but I've also given you the structure. As two of you become one in every possible sense. And that is a lifelong pursuit. A lifelong journey, and it doesn't happen easily, it doesn't happen quickly, and you learn through your pain, and we learn through our mistakes, and we learn the same things again, but that is the biggest prize of all. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that you've not only created us, but you provided the context for which the creations that we are might find fulfillment and purpose. Forgive us that we've elevated sex to such an unrealistic and high place that can only but disappoint us in the course of time. And I pray for those of us here this morning who need to confess to you our failings, our sins, knowing that you forgive, but knowing too there is a time for healing and restoration which we ask that you bring into our lives. We might be the whole people you create us to be. That those of us who are married here this morning, that we might enjoy that oneness on every level that you want us to enjoy it. That we care and love and belong to and give to and protect and nurture each other. Make this our desire and make this real for us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel.
Join Living Truth next week for another insightful message on gender and sexuality. Summer is finally here, and so is the Living Truth Summer Sale. Living Truth has compiled four of the most requested series, containing over 25 inspiring messages by Charles Price. Now, you can take advantage of Living Truth's summer set. Acts 2, Lessons from Early Christians. How Should We Now Live? The Ten Commandments for Today's World. Journey into the Heart of God, a rejuvenating series on prayer. Gender and Sexuality. What Our Sexuality Means to God. Get the entire CD set for only $75. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this amazing collection, write to the address on your screen. order online, visit livingtruth.ca. This summer, experience the transforming power of God's Word. Write to us today.
You might recognize this as the building where we produce our weekly program here at the People's Church in Toronto, Canada. This facility is Mission Central, a home base to mobilize people and resources for God's global mission. From here, we've built many fruitful relationships all around the world during our lengthy 40-year television history, which now goes out to more than 60 countries in a variety of languages.
Since 1973, the People's Worship Hour, as it was originally called, had a vision to extend the reach of the gospel beyond the walls of the People's Church in Toronto. The People's Worship Hour became Living Truth in 2002. Now, 14 years later, we're taking a long-awaited step in refreshing our current program format.
This summer, we're calling our campaign, It Starts Here. Our home is here. And from this sanctuary, we record our programs and send them to our production studios from where it goes out to the world as what we like to think of as a trusted program that impacts positively the lives of many who seek a deeper relationship with Christ. Keeping our production spaces in good working order is much like keeping your own home in good condition. There's always something that needs repairing or replacing. Our production facility is aging, and it is in need. Your financial support will help us purchase and refurbish much needed lighting and also a needed studio. We anticipate this cost to be $250,000 in total, and with your help, we hope to begin our work this fall. These upgrades will greatly enhance our production value and our ability to continue creating the kind of clear, biblical teaching program that you know and trust and which goes out to so many places all around the world. When we say it starts here, the it includes starting with many of you, our viewers, and we are grateful to you.
We urge you to prayerfully consider partnering with us during our It Starts Here campaign. To offer your financial support to Living Truth, send a check to the address on your screen or call 1-888-269-6085 and make a donation with your credit card. Or you can make a secure donation online at livingtruth.ca. Living Truth is a registered charity, and all donations are tax deductible. Thank you for your faithful and generous support.
After 40 years of broadcasting, now more than any other time, we need to update and renovate Living Truth. I'm asking for your financial support to enable us to continue as good stewards of this facility that God has entrusted to us. With His help, we want to accomplish His purpose, specifically impacting the lives of many people all around the world, including yours. Thank you so very much.
And all our praises, and all our worship, and all our praises. I praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise the Father.
praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts.
Oh,